So, Solvite Omnes, today we're going to talk about Apollo, the god of prophecy, the god of music, the god of light, and I'm just going to go through one of his famous myths about him. Of course, remember, Apollo is the son of Zeus and Leto. His sister is Artemis. He's often associated with archery as well, and you can see him. He'll either be carrying a lyre, or he'll also be carrying a bow and arrow. So he's often called the god of the golden bow. And he can also, besides being like, he's also god of medicine. His son is Asclepius. And there's many stories associated with him. He's also associated with reason, logic. And when you see him, he's often portrayed as a young, vibrant male. He often has a top knot thing here. But he's young, virile. One of the most famous stories about him is the story of Apollo and Daphne. And so after he was born, he went on many adventures. He was born on the island of Delos, of course, and he went out and killed the Python later on, a giant snake that lived at Delphi in central Greece. And afterwards, he created a temple there and his oracle, so people could come to the oracle in ancient times and find out about the future. And Apollo, and it was dedicated to Apollo. And after doing that, he happened to be wandering through the woods, and he ran into Cupid, the god of love. And Cupid, like Apollo, is an archer. But Apollo was not impressed by Cupid's bow. He said, "Impudent boy, what are you doing with a man's weapon? That one is suited to my soldiers, since I can hit wild beasts, certainly, and I can wound my enemy. And not long ago, I destroyed with countless arrows the swollen python that covered many acres with its plague-ridden belly. You should be intent on stirring the concealed fires of love with your burning brand and not claiming to my glory. So don't... These weapons are not for you, Cupid." But of course, Cupid was not pleased about this. He replied, "You may hit every other being, Phoebus, Apollo, but my bow will strike you. To the degree that all living creatures are less than gods, by that degree is your glory less than mine." Ooh, not so good. He spoke, and striking the air fiercely with the beating wings, he landed on a shady peak of Mount Parnassus, so a mountain nearby. Took two arrows from his quiver, one that kindles love, and another one that causes love to flee. And so with its sharp point that brings love, he shot Apollo. And then with the other arrow, he shot Daphne. All right. And so when Daphne was a daughter of a river, and she, after being hit by Cupid's arrows, fled all idea of love. She started dressing like Diana, wearing animal skins, warming the forest, not caring for herself. And her father, who was a river, said to Daphne, "You owe me a son-in-law. I want you to get married." But she gave her father a hug and said, "Dad, I want to be a maiden forever. I don't want, please let me be unmarried. You know, Zeus granted this to Artemis, to Diana. Why can't I be unmarried as well?" And so the father said, "Okay." But of course, after Apollo had been hit by this arrow, who did he catch sight of first? Was Daphne. And he fell madly in love with her. And he wanted to marry her. But his own prophetic powers failed him. Now, when he saw her through the forest, he was entranced by her beauty, her ruggedness. And he said to her through the forest when he caught hold of her, he says, "Wait, nymph, daughter of Phineas, I beg you, I who am chasing you are not your enemy. Please stop." Because, of course, once Apollo started approaching her, Daphne ran away. And he says, "This is the way the sheep runs from the wolf. A deer from a mountain lion," Apollo went on. "A dove with fluttering wings flies from the eagle. Everything flies from its foe, but it is love that is driving me to follow you. Pity me. I'm afraid you might fall headlong on thorns, undeservedly scar your legs, and I might be a cause of grief to you. There are rough places. Run slowly, Daphne. Because by this point, Daphne had started taking off. At least inquire whom it is you have charmed. I am no mountain man, no shepherd, no rough guardian of the herds and flocks. Rash girl, you do not know. You cannot realize you run from who? It's me, Apollo. Delphi's lands are mine. Claros and Tendos and Patra acknowledge me king. Jupiter is my dad. Through me, what was, what is, and what will be revealed. Through me, strings sound in harmony to song. My aim is certain, but an arrow truer than mine has wounded my heart. The whole world calls me the bringer of aid. Medicine is my invention. My power is in the herbs. But love cannot be healed by any herb, nor can the arts which cure others cure their lord. He would have continued to talk, but of course Daphne started running. And as she ran, her in flight made her look even more beautiful, and his love, it blazed even more. And he was concerned that she might hurt herself, but he still pursued her because he was in love. Now she ran fast, but of course love makes everyone swift. And as she started to tire, Apollo started getting closer and closer, and he goes to grab her, and Daphne screams, "Help me, father," because her father's a river. "If your streams have divine powers, change me. Destroy this beauty does not please me at all." Her prayer was scarcely done when a heavy numbness seized her limbs, and then thin bark started to go over her body, going up to her chest, and then her hair started turning to leaves. Her arms reached in the sky, leaves sprouted out. Her feet that were so quick a moment ago stuck fast to the ground, and roots shot forth into the ground. Only thing she had turned into a laurel tree. The only thing left was her beauty. Even with this, though, Phoebus Apollo was still in love. He placed his hand against her trunk. He felt her heart still quivering under the bark. He clasped the branches as if they were parts of human arms and kissed the wood. But the tree shrank from his kisses. And he said to the tree, "Since you cannot be my bride, you must be my tree. Laurel with my hair, with you my hair will be wreathed, with my lyre, with you on my quiver. You will go with the Roman generals and joyful voices acclaim their triumph, and the capital witnesses their long possessions. You will stand outside Augustus' doorsteps, a faithful guardian, and keep watch over the crown of oak between them. And just as my hand with its uncropped hair is always young, so you will always wear the beauty of undying leaves." He had finished. The laurel tree, after hearing the speech, bowed her branches in agreement and gave consent. And there we go. That's the end of the story of Apollo and Daphne. Volete omnes, lingua latina est vita.